Good afternoon. The first item of business this afternoon is portfolio questions. The first portfolio is COVID-19 recovery and parliamentary business. I'd remind members that questions 5 and 7 have been grouped together, so I will take supplementaries on those questions after both have been answered. Those requesting supplementaries should press the request to speak buttons during the relevant question, and I can advise the Chamber that there is an awful lot of interest in supplementaries, so if we could have questions that are devoid of lengthy preambles and answers that are as brief as possible, we'll get through them all the more quickly. And I call question number 1, Christine Graham.
Thank you very much. I'll try to set a good example, Deputy Presiding Officer. For once, to ask the Scottish Government what assessment it has made as part of its cross-government coordination of COVID recovery policies of the wider ongoing impact of COVID-19, including on the economy.
Cabinet Secretary John Swinney.
President Officer, the COVID recovery strategy brings together over 70 actions that are supporting those most impacted during the pandemic and ongoing cost crisis by increasing financial security for low-income households, enhancing the well-being of children and young people and creating good green jobs and fair work. This activity is supported by the themes of the Scottish Government's National Strategy for Economic Transformation and work that involves the support for digital recovery and support for our energy sector through the Energy Transition Fund. We are also providing significant investment to support businesses, including almost £500 million more than the funding we receive from the United Kingdom Government.
Christine Graham.
I thank the Deputy First Minister for his answer. Can I ask, with specific reference to my own constituency, if we have any data of the impact on the economies in Midlothian and the borders, and if the Deputy First Minister doesn't have that to hand, will he write and provide me with it, please?
Cabinet Secretary.
I'm very happy to draw out as much detailed information as I can in a follow-up response to Christine Graham. But what I would say is that obviously on some of the key indicators, such as levels of unemployment, we have historically low unemployment across Scotland, historically high employment across Scotland, and these factors will be felt acutely in an area like Midlothian where it has, and the borders, particularly Midlothian, where there is such strong accessibility to labour markets. But I will look to see what further, more detailed information I can provide to the member.
And brief supplementary, first, Murdo Fraser.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. One of the economic impacts of COVID has been the acceleration in decline of traditional retail centres, and we've seen just this week the closure of M&Co stores across Scotland, which will just contribute to that. Has the Scottish Government done any assessment of the impact on traditional town and city centres from the expansion of working from home across the public sector?
Cabinet Secretary.
Obviously, the factors affecting town centres and the retail community will be affected by a range of different factors. COVID and the impact of lockdown will be one. The move towards the greater use of online retail opportunities will be another. And a third will undoubtedly be the impact of more people proportionately working at home since the pandemic than was the case before the pandemic. The government undertakes an active amount of work to look at the impact on town centres. Indeed, parliamentary committees have reported on this subject, and all of these different factors are researched and reflected in the thinking the government brings together on its retail strategy.
And briefly, Paul Skeen.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. One of the major legacies of the COVID pandemic has been mental health and the impact in Scotland. So what is the Deputy First Minister's response to reports that there were no mental health beds available in Scotland last weekend? And what steps are the government taking to honour their pledge to increase mental health funding to 10% of the total NHS budget when funding has been frozen in the coming financial year?
Cabinet Secretary.
Obviously, the mental health budget has increased and we have greater capacity to support individuals to assist in their recovery. There are obviously a variety of other steps that the government takes to enhance community mental health resources within our society, particularly within the school community is one other example that comes to mind. So the government will endeavour to expand where the resources allow the investment in mental health and wellbeing services, recognising the importance of supporting people in their recovery.
Question 2, Jamie Hopper-Johnson.
To ask the Scottish Government whether it will provide an update on the COVID-19 inquiry.
Cabinet Secretary.
As an independent public inquiry, it is for the Scottish COVID-19 inquiry itself to comment on its work, including through its website, covid19inquiry.scot, as it progresses. The Scottish Government remains committed in its role as sponsor to providing operational support as the Chair considers necessary and appropriate in order to enable the inquiry to carry out its independent work and to help ensure the progress made so far is continued. We want the inquiry to be delivered at speed, addressing the range of questions that people have so that we can learn and benefit from lessons as early as possible.
Jamie Hawker-Johnson.
Thank the Cabinet Secretary for that answer. It's been reported recently that the former chair of the Scottish COVID-19 inquiry, Lady Poole, raised a number of issues with the inquiry before her resignation, and that the Deputy First Minister personally offered a phone call to try and get her to change her mind, but she declined to do so. It would appear that numerous issues were piling up with the inquiry and Lady Poole felt she had no option but to step down. So can I ask the Deputy First Minister why he let these problems build up to the point of resignation and not address them at an earlier stage? And with millions of pounds of taxpayer money already spent on this inquiry, what lessons have been learned to ensure the same issues, delays and costs don't arise going forward?
Cabinet Secretary.
I think Mr Hawker-Johnson's question raises a perspective on an independent public inquiry that has to be countered. Conservative members would be outraged if I was to interfere in the operation of an independent public inquiry. Outraged. Indeed, Mr Fraser on the front bench accused me of so doing. So here we have one member of the Conservative Party asking me to interfere in an inquiry, Mr Hawker-Johnson, and Mr Fraser accusing me of doing the same thing that Mr Hawker-Johnson is alleging. So really, when an independent public inquiry is established, and the law is very clear on this point, I've rehearsed this in parliamentary statements, the law is very clear. Once a chair is appointed, it is up to the chair to run the public inquiry. It's not for ministers to interfere, and I don't do that.
Question number three, Willie Coffin.
Thank you. To ask the Scottish Government what cross-government assessment it has made of the impact of its COVID recovery policies, including whether any might continue into the future.
Cabinet Secretary.
President Officer, the COVID recovery strategy contains a range of actions, many of which will continue beyond the lifetime of the strategy. The principles of the COVID recovery strategy helped inform the 2023-24 Scottish Budget, which prioritises eradicating child poverty, transforming the economy to deliver a just transition to net zero, and achieving fiscally sustainable public services. And the Scottish Government will continue to prioritise policies which support those in most need. I co-chair the COVID Recovery Strategy Programme Board alongside the COSLA President. Together with partners, we oversee recovery activity that is supporting people in Scotland, particularly those most affected by the pandemic and the ongoing cost crisis.
Willie Coffin.
Can I thank the Deputy First Minister for that answer and to hopefully provide a useful contrast to the earlier question. The Deputy First Minister will be aware of some of the more positive outcomes from COVID, for example, the digital transformation that occurred in the workplace and in here too, and local project initiatives that emerged initially as emergency support, but which have become an important part of local community work today, not only in my constituency, but also evident in the impressive Engage Renfrewshire work that we saw on Monday with our Housing Committee. Does the Deputy First Minister share my view that these positive developments, born out of COVID, are making a real difference to people and communities? And can he consider if funding models for important community work in particular might be retained in the future and not lost simply because the COVID funding may have come to an end?
Cabinet Secretary.
I think there's a lot of merit in the points that Mr Coffey has raised. We saw a tremendous development of innovative community development practice during COVID, where solutions were found by communities for individuals, and the Government is intent on encouraging and nurturing that approach. I think it is important to be on our guard for a return to old ways of working. Some of the new ways of working that developed during COVID have been of great benefit and advantage to our society and our communities, and we want to make sure that we preserve those in the future. And I assure Mr Coffey that the Government is trying to design its funding interventions, particularly, for example, measures such as the Dundee Pathfinder work on doing exactly that.
And supplementary, Jackie Bailey.
Last week I met with Unite the Union and concerned employees from the Glasgow Lighthouse Lab to discuss the future of this facility in light of concerns about further redundancies in the coming weeks. Is the Cabinet Secretary will be aware that this lab, which is Scotland's flagship COVID-19 testing facility, processed over 26 million tests, but has already lost experienced and highly skilled employees, including sample handlers and lab technicians, in a previous round of redundancies. Can the Cabinet Secretary outline what meetings the Scottish Government has had with the University of Glasgow regarding the future of the Glasgow Lighthouse Lab? And given that COVID has not gone away, will he intervene to ensure that this important capacity is retained?
Cabinet Secretary.
I think Jackie Bailey will be aware from the discussions that we had at the COVID-19 committee in relation to the budget that the government is retaining enhanced testing facilities beyond what we had prior to COVID to ensure that we have a capability and a capacity to undertake testing activity. Obviously, I'll inquire about specific dialogue with the University of Glasgow and by health ministers in relation to the Lighthouse Lab, but I think Jackie Bailey should be assured of the commitment of the government to ensure that we have the appropriate measures in place to ensure that we can deal with the COVID pandemic, which of course is still with us, but thankfully with much lower prevalence than has been the case in the past, and we obviously have much greater population protection through the vaccination programme.
Question number four, Liz Smith.
To ask the Scottish Government how it plans to spend the proposed COVID recovery portfolio 2023-24 budget allocation.
Cabinet Secretary.
So the COVID recovery portfolio supports the Scottish Government's commitment to renewing public services through public service reform, the delivery of the COVID recovery strategy, which is supporting those most impacted during the pandemic and the ongoing cost crisis, and its contributions to the coordination of recovery across the Scottish Government. As detailed in the 2023-24 budget statement, this budget line also includes a range of commitments, including work to support the operation of the Scottish Public Inquiry into the handling of COVID-19 and work on preparedness assessment and coordination of concurrent risk across the Scottish Government.
Can I thank the Cabinet Secretary on a related issue, however, at the end of last year in relation to the letter that Richard McCallum, Director of Health Finance within the Scottish Government, sent to IGBs. There was a considerable concern at the time that a total of £331 million of COVID money across the IGBs would be clawed back by the Scottish Government. And the Scottish Government said, and I quote, "This money is being used to fund COVID pressures across the health sector and for no other purpose." Cabinet Secretary, can we just get some clarity on exactly what that money has been spent on?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, I think it's pretty obvious that the budget is under enormous financial pressure. Liz Smith is a member of the Finance Committee. I've been completely candid about the challenges that I face in balancing the budget this year because of the impact of inflation and the increased costs with which we are wrestling. So I've come to Parliament and I have reallocated £1.2 billion worth of resources to meet the funding pressures. It's not any secret that we're facing those particular issues and pressures, but the government is acting to address them. In relation to the IGB funding question, I think it's elementary common sense that where there are reserves being held in IGBs that can be utilised to support frontline activity, it's a clear preference of the government for that to be the case.
And brief supplementary, Paul O'Kane.
Thank you. Given the pressures faced by unpaid carers, who are one of the groups most adversely affected by the pandemic, not least due to rising energy bills, which have been articulated in this chamber at First Minister's questions, coupled with their needs now in recovery, what does the Deputy First Minister intend to do to support unpaid carers through the COVID recovery budget, not least with testing, antivirals and PPE?
Cabinet Secretary.
As Mr O'Kane may be aware, there is provision within the health budget for the maintenance of the pandemic preparedness on many of the issues that he raises around about PPE and testing arrangements, as I rehearsed in my answer to Jackie Bailey. So that provision has been made on a prudential basis. We all hope that we don't have to increase the scale of investment that is required there, but there is provision made within the budget to enable that to be the case, and of course that support would be available to those who require that support, and in many cases I would imagine that would be in relation to carers who would have eligibility for that, that support.
Question number five, Richard Leonard.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government how its cross-government coordination of COVID recovery policies is supporting data collection to assess the impact of long COVID.
Cabinet Secretary.
The Scottish Government is committed to delivering a fair recovery for everyone in Scotland, particularly those most affected by the pandemic, which includes those affected by long COVID. We are supporting activity to improve the collection of clinical data on the prevalence and healthcare needs of people with long COVID to inform the planning and delivery of services. Officials are working with NHS National Services Scotland's Long COVID Strategic Network to improve data collection as a priority. The network is taking forward a dedicated workstream to agree outcomes, indicators, monitoring and evaluation to accelerate progress.
Richard Leonard.
Can I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that answer? In August, the Cabinet Secretary for Health said in a parliamentary answer to me that the number of people diagnosed with long COVID in Scotland was, I quote, a matter for NHS boards. The information requested is not held centrally. In the same answer, he said that the government recognised that accurate data on the number of people diagnosed with long COVID is needed to forecast and plan for healthcare services arising from long COVID. So I asked the Cabinet Secretary for COVID Recovery, the Deputy First Minister, the Minister in charge of Government Statistics, the Minister in charge of Government Strategy, does he agree with the Cabinet Secretary for Health that this is a matter for NHS boards, or does he recognise the benefit of the Scottish Government collecting this data, publishing this data, keeping an accurate record of that data in order to plan and properly resource nationally the vital services that long COVID sufferers so desperately need?
Cabinet Secretary.
There's 2 points I'd make in relation to Mr Leonard's question. The first is really to reiterate what I said in my original answer, which is that there is work underway with NHS National Services Scotland's Long COVID Strategic Network to improve that data collection. So I think that substantively addresses the point that Mr Leonard is putting to me. The second point I would say is in relation to the support for people with long COVID. And the government is very clear that we have to make sure that anybody who is experiencing ill health, whether that's from long COVID or anything else, is able to access the appropriate level of clinical care to support their needs and their requirements. And that is primarily undertaken through access through the GP network within Scotland. And I would encourage anybody who is experiencing that ill health to pursue those options and to ensure they secure the necessary care to which they are entitled.
Question number seven, Stuart McMillan.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, to ask the Scottish Government what discussions it has had as part of its cross-government coordination of COVID recovery policies regarding the wider impact of long COVID, including on the economy and workforce.
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, the Scottish Government recognises the impact that long COVID can have on the health and wellbeing of those affected, including on their ability to stay in employment. While there have been increases in the number of people who are economically inactive due to sickness since before the pandemic, the extent to which this is attributable solely to long COVID is not yet clear. We are investing in scientific efforts to understand and treat long COVID, and we have made funding available to NHS boards and partners to deliver the best local models of care for assessment, diagnostic tests and support for ongoing management or treatment of symptoms. Through our Fair Work agenda, we are also explaining to and supporting employers so they can support workers living with long COVID to remain in employment.
Stuart McMillan.
I thank the Deputy First Minister for that reply, and I'm concerned that people with long COVID may find themselves locked out of employment if they're not given the adequate support to return to work. This is especially true if the person's job cannot be done from home, such as nurses, for example. Can I ask then, what is the Scottish Government strategy to actually help ensure that people working within our NHS who are suffering from long COVID are supported to return to work where possible, and where they can't return to work, other options are explored to help them stay in employment?
Cabinet Secretary.
There's a priority across the whole of government for us to maximise the available level of participation within the labour market. We want to maximise the number of people who are available to actively contribute to the labour market. As I said in my response to Christine Graham, we have low levels of unemployment and high levels of employment, and the labour market is very tight. So encouraging people who have long COVID to be able to return to work through all the necessary clinical support and mental wellbeing support and any other assistance that is required should be available to them. And if there is a case for individuals to find alternative employment, we should be open to providing the training and the skills enhancement activity that will support them in making that transition.
Question number six, Stephen Kerr.
To ask the Scottish Government what plans it has to propose time for a debate in Parliament on parliamentary reform.
Mr George Adam.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and I thank Mr Kerr for his question. The Scottish Parliament is responsible for all matters relating to its functions and internal operation. The Government would encourage any member wishing to propose reform of current parliamentary procedures to raise such proposals with the Standards, Procedures and Public Appointments Committee. The Government stands ready, if invited, to discuss any reform proposals with the Parliament.
Stephen Kerr.
Well, didn't answer my question. I was asking if there was time for a debate. But the Minister will be aware that there is a clear desire and appetite from members across this chamber to see our Parliament reformed. It's also apparent there's scope for common ground between colleagues and all parties in this Parliament for reform. And we all want to see the Scottish Parliament effectively fulfilling its appointed role, both in its function as a legislature and in its day-to-day scrutiny of the executive. So will the Minister confirm to the Chamber on behalf of the Government that he and his ministerial colleagues will be supportive of such reforms that may be initiated by the Standards and Procedures Committee and engage positively with all interested parties, including my colleague Donald Cameron, to secure such reforms as may be determined to be needed to enable the Parliament to be effective in carrying out the business of the people of Scotland.
Minister.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And as always, Mr Kerr and I seem to have a communication problem. I'll try and say it again. The Scottish Government stands ready, if invited, to discuss any reform proposals with the Parliament. And as always, when he also mentions Donald Cameron, once again, when Donald Cameron asked in the Chamber on the 18th of January, I actually said, although I didn't agree with Mr Cameron's summation of the situation, I was happy to meet up with him and discuss further. And this meeting is scheduled for the 2nd of March. So as always, Presiding Officer, the Government is willing to engage with anyone.
Be supplementary, Martin Whitford.
I'm very grateful, Deputy Presiding Officer, and it is right that a decision about parliamentary reform should sit here within this chamber and here within this Parliament rather than with the Scottish Government. But would the Minister agree that the Scottish Government would cooperate with committees and indeed this chamber with regard to any inquiries as to reform of parliamentary procedure?
Minister.
As always, Mr Whitfield, I am happy to engage with the committee, and I have done on numerous occasions with yourself as convener, and we will happily get involved in any future work that your committee should bring to us. And like any other member of this Parliament, we will look at it and take it from there.
Briefly, Bill Kidd.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Minister, you'll be aware of the DPLR committee report on retained EU law bill, where concerns are raised about the amount of time available for the Scottish Parliament to scrutinise the elements of the bill. Does the Minister have any concerns regarding the amount of time available to the Scottish Parliament to give adequate scrutiny to the bill as it is drafted?
Very briefly, Minister.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Yes, the member will be aware we had this question at the DPLR committee yesterday, and the Scottish Government is taking forward the work to identify retained EU law so that it can be preserved before the end of 2023. It's too early at this stage to know what the impact will be on wider legislative programme, but this has been kept under review.
Thank you. Question 8, Katie Clarke.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And can I apologise, I only arrived as portfolio questions were starting. To ask the Scottish Government what steps it is taking through its COVID recovery strategy to support students.
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, the COVID recovery strategy is focused on reducing systemic inequalities, tackling poverty and supporting people most affected during the pandemic. This includes a range of actions to support and enhance the wellbeing of all children and young people, including through investing a further £45 million in our Young Persons Guarantee in 2022-23. Further detail and support being provided to students is set out in our Coronavirus Education Recovery Strategy, which describes a range of advice, guidance and funding provided with regard to mental health, wellbeing and tackling digital poverty.
Katie Clark.
Thank you. In the COVID-19 recovery strategy, the Scottish Government states that it recognises the significant cost of rent for many households. A recent report commissioned by the National Union of Students has found that in student accommodation, rents increased by 34% between 2018 and 2021. Will the Cabinet Secretary commit to reinstating the rent freeze for student accommodation until a permanent system of rent controls is put in place?
Cabinet Secretary.
I certainly can't commit to that this afternoon. That's quite a big undertaking to give. But I will take the issues that Katie Clark has raised. Obviously, the Government has taken measures which have been properly considered by Parliament to apply a freeze on rents. We have legislative provisions that are underway, as Katie Clark will know. But I'll certainly take away the point that she's raised and ensure it's considered by the relevant ministers.
And very briefly, Stephanie Callaghan.
I welcome the support set out for students during the cost of living crisis, which I know is weighing really heavily in their minds just now. And I'm wondering if the Deputy First Minister can provide an update on mental health and wellbeing support that's available to students.
And as briefly as possible, Cabinet Secretary.
So we've supported the NUS Think Positive initiative, which helps to signpost students to places where they can get help, and through student mental health agreements, student associations and institutions can work jointly on mental health practices. And the Government, there is work on the strategic delivery of this work, which is taken forward by a working group chaired by the Minister for Higher Education, which is determined to ensure that we have the necessary steps in place to protect the mental wellbeing of young people and students.
Thank you very much, Cabinet Secretary. That concludes portfolio questions on COVID-19 recovery and parliamentary business. It's time to move on to the next portfolio, which is finance and the economy. I would remind members that questions 6 and 7 are grouped together and that I'll take supplementaries on those questions after both have been answered. And the usual request, if somebody wants a supplementary, they should press the request to speak buttons during the relevant questions. Again, a lot of interest, so the same brevity in questions and responses would be much appreciated. Question number 1, Willie Rennie.
To ask the Scottish Government whether it will provide an update on its commitment to deliver superfast broadband to 100% off premises in Scotland by 2021.
Minister Ivan McKee.
As at the 31st of December 2021, all homes and businesses across Scotland had the ability to access a superfast broadband connection through one of the three strands of activity that make up the R100 programme. The £600 million R100 contracts, the demand-led R100 Scottish Broadband Voucher Scheme and through commercial coverage. By the end of December 2022, the R100 contracts had built connections to over 16,600 properties across the length and breadth of Scotland, with over 2,800 connections also delivered through R100 vouchers.
Willie Rennie.
The Minister must think I'm zipped up the back if he's expecting me to believe that answer. It was not delivered by the end of 2021. I personally don't have superfast broadband in my house, and I am not alone. There are hundreds of thousands of other people across Scotland that don't have superfast broadband. Therefore, it isn't 100%. A new Freedom of Information release found that it won't be delivered until March 2028, almost 7 years late. Why is the Minister insisting he's met the election promise when he clearly hasn't?
Minister.
As I indicated in my previous answer, the voucher scheme was put in place to ensure that anyone that wanted to connect as at that date was able to do so. We continue to roll out the programme as planned. Commitment of £600 million to support that, bearing in mind, of course, that telecoms provision is a reserved matter, but the Scottish Government recognises the importance of this to communities, businesses and their families across Scotland, and hence our commitment to spend that additional £600 million to roll out this programme.
Brief supplementary, first, Jenny Mint.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Can the Cabinet Secretary provide any update regarding the Scottish Government's latest engagement with the UK Government regarding the funding available to deliver its Project Gigabit commitment?
Minister.
The Scottish Government continues to work closely with the UK Government to help shape what Project Gigabit will look like in Scotland. To date, we have secured £28.5 million of that funding, which has been used to enhance and extend R100 contract coverage across rural Scotland. But the UK Government has not provided a Scotland-wide allocation of Project Gigabit funding that would allow things to move forward at maximum pace. And I should recognise that £28 million funding is out of a total of £1.2 billion confirmed by the UK Government, which again is out of a total of £5 billion that they originally committed to that programme. In the weeks ahead, we will be engaging with the broadband infrastructure providers to understand their current and future gigabit delivery plans and to gauge the level of interest in bidding for new broadband contracts in Scotland. But it's vital that the UK Government commits a level of funding that will extend gigabit connectivity to Scotland's rural and island communities, as well as urban and semi-urban areas, to ensure that no one is left behind.
And briefly, Jamie Huckle-Jones.
In the last week or so, damaged cable led to broadband outages in some communities in Orkney in the north of Caithness, and follows damage to two cables in October, leaving shortages in Shetland. So can I ask the Minister what ongoing discussions are taking place with network providers to reduce the potential for disruptions and to increase network resilience?
Minister.
We are engaged in discussions to ensure that those outages are there's as much resilience as possible in the system to ensure that those are protected against. Clearly, there will be the possibility of freak incidents happening, but as I say, the connectivity, the subsea cables that we've put in place to extend coverage and the work that is taking place to ensure resilience across the system will continue.
Question number two, Polly McNeill.
To ask the Scottish Government what assessment it has made of the impact of investment levels on the status of Greater Glasgow and Clyde area, including how this compares to similar city regions across the UK.
Minister Richard Lockie.
As part of the consultation process for the National Strategy for Economic Transformation, the Scottish Government received information on every region in Scotland, and the information received shows a varied landscape with a number of economic strengths from clean growth to aerospace. As a member will be aware, the Scottish Government is investing £500 million into the Glasgow City Region deal, which aims to lever in an estimated £3.3 billion of private sector investment to support the delivery of projects, work with 4,000 individuals and help at least 600 ECA claimants into sustained work. And we're committed to spreading the benefits of economic growth across the Glasgow City Region, ensuring deprived areas benefit from this growth.
Polly McNeill.
I'd like to put on record that I welcome that investment, but the Scottish Government doesn't seem to recognise that Glasgow today has an economy which is underperforming the European average for growth and productivity and has a smaller voice within the British and Scottish growth debates than a city of its stature, being the largest city in Scotland. And the decision, and I raised this yesterday, not to award the Clyde Green Freeport was an extremely significant blow to Glasgow. I don't think this has been recognised by the Scottish Government. Stuart Patrick, Chief Executive of the Glasgow Chamber of Commerce, said, overlooking Scotland's entire west coast risks making both the UK Government's levelling up strategy and the delivery of the Scottish Government's commitment to a Clyde mission extremely challenging. What does the Minister say to this in response? And can he tell me what plans it has to ensure that Glasgow, as one of the big four UK cities outside of London, is not being left, behind, being the most locked down city during the pandemic of the whole of the UK?
Minister.
I want to assure the Member that the Scottish Government absolutely supports Glasgow City's and the wider region's aspirations. And I've been looking at some of the funding awards from the last few weeks alone, and I see that from the vacant and derelict land investment programme, that Glasgow has benefited from that for some transformational projects, including the Govan engraving docks, which have lain empty for 40 years. I've looked at the government's recycling improvement fund, which also gave awards to Glasgow as well, with some exciting projects there. And of course, we've got the Regeneration Capital Grant Fund also, which has awarded some projects in Glasgow as well, including transforming a former pipe factory in Glasgow into a community centre and creative hub for young people. And that's just to name a few of the awards that have gone to Glasgow and the surrounding region just in the last few weeks alone. Unlike, of course, what we've seen from the UK Government with the Levelling Up Fund being an absolute damp squib and failing Glasgow, the wider city region and the rest of Scotland. So I just want to assure the Member that this Government will continue to support the city's aspirations.
And briefly, John Mason.
Yeah, thank you. The Minister mentioned the city deal, and I wonder if you can comment any more about the city deal and how it does it actually compensate for the money we lost through levelling up?
Minister.
Well, the deal, as you know, empowers Glasgow and the region to identify, manage and deliver a programme of investment to stimulate economic growth and create jobs in the area. So that funding is issued twice per year using the own agreed governance to distribute the projects according to all eight local authorities' wishes across that region. And one such example is the bridge over the M8, which is due to open soon. And the bridge forms an active travel route linking Sight Hill and the city centre, and is part of the £250 million regeneration project for Sight Hill, which will improve the economic flow between all of those areas. So that's just one example of the project. In terms of compensating for levelling up, well, as I said just to Parliament, out of the £3.8 billion allocated for levelling up across the UK by the UK Government, many parts of Scotland, particularly those areas most in need, like many areas of Glasgow, have been completely ignored and not received a penny.
Question number three was not lodged. Question four, Standish Gohani.
To ask the Scottish Government what it is doing to encourage business activity in Scotland.
Minister Aidan McKee.
We know businesses in Scotland are struggling because of Brexit and the Tory government's economic mismanagement, and that is why the Scottish Government is providing, through our limited levers, immediate support, including the lowest non-domestic rates poundage in the UK. At the same time, we are delivering our national strategy for economic transformation to achieve our long-term ambitions for a stronger, fairer and greener economy, and the strategy programme's focus on stimulating entrepreneurship, opening new markets, increasing productivity, developing the skills we need, ensuring a fairer and more equal economic opportunities. We are working closely with delivery partners, businesses, the third sector and trade unions to successfully implement the strategy.
Sandis Gohan.
Businesses across Scotland have raised their significant concerns regarding the SNP Green Government's rollout of the deposit return scheme, calling it completely unworkable, negative and complicated. This will put jobs at risk and add a massive burden to businesses at a time when they need support and discourage business. Stakeholders are clear that these plans are poorly thought through and the Scottish Government is not giving enough attention to these concerns. So will the Scottish Government listen to businesses and only commit to launching the scheme once businesses have had the answers they desperately need?
Minister.
We are very conscious of the need to engage with businesses. That's why we have such an extensive programme of engaging, listening to and responding to the needs of business. That's why I am chairing the Business Regulation Task Force that was set up by Deputy First Minister, which has now had two meetings in the last few weeks, to work closely with those across the business community to assess the impact of regulations, to make sure that the business regulation impact assessments are doing their job in ensuring we flush out any issues and to address issues around about cumulative impact of different regulations as they impact the business community. So we are focused on listening to business. We are focused on working with business to make sure those regulations that my colleague Lorna Slater is taking forward on deposit return and all our regulations coming forward from government that impact on businesses are properly assessed, and that we do listen to businesses to make sure their views, concerns on those regulations are taken into account.
Remind colleagues, we're listening to the answers with respect. Could I ask that we also listen to the answers that are given to those questions with respect? A brief supplementary from Fiona Hislop.
On Friday, many of us took part in the very successful Business in Parliament event hosted jointly by the Economy and Fair Work Committee and the Scottish Government. Would the Minister join with me in thanking the Parliament and Government staff who made it possible for the 250 delegates from business and MSPs to come together to have frank but very positive discussions about the issues businesses across Scotland are facing?
Briefly as possible, Minister.
Yeah, I also took part in the Business in Parliament conference myself and was hugely impressed by the contributions that were made by a wide range of businesses in the plenary sessions and in the workshop that I took part in. And I also would like to thank the parliamentary staff and others who were involved in putting on that event. It's one of a whole series, a range of events that the government takes part in to ensure that we are working with business, listening to business, reflecting their concerns and hearing from a wide range of businesses across all sectors in Scotland to make sure we work together to build and strengthen Scotland's economy.
Thank you. Question 5, Jim Fairley.
Thank you, President Officer. I'd like to ask the Scottish Government what assessment it has made of the potential impact on Scotland of the recent analysis by the International Monetary Fund, which found the UK economy is set to shrink by 0.6% in 2023.
Minister Richard Law.
As set out in the Scottish Government's recent monthly economic brief, the Scottish economy is facing a challenging outlook, and as the IMF projection shows, a lot of that challenge is down to the UK Government's economic mismanagement. As the IMF also highlights, labour market shortages are affecting Scotland and the UK more than other countries, and these have been made much worse by Brexit, which continues to hold back our economy and make it harder for Scotland to deliver fairer and more sustainable economic growth.
Jim Fairley.
I'd like to thank the Minister for that answer. It's now more than 3 years since the UK left the European Union, and despite all the promises that Brexit would bring a new era of prosperity for all, it's leading to a long-term damage to the Scottish economy, and the decision is contributing towards the UK becoming the poor man of Europe. Now that Labour have become the new champions of making Brexit work, does the Cabinet Secretary agree with me that the only way to recover from the damage of leaving the EU and protect Scotland's future is to be an independent country?
Minister.
Unsurprisingly, I do agree with the member's point. The evidence is, of course, that Brexit has been disastrous for Scotland, and the Scottish Government analysis shows that Scotland's trade in goods, for instance, with the EU is 12% lower in 2021 because of Brexit. And there have been so many other warnings. Indeed, the combination of the UK Tory government's austerity agenda and Brexit must amount to the two gravest economic errors of our lifetimes, and they are imposing enormous damage on the Scottish economy and our people's life chances. So it is indeed the case that to help repair the damage, if Scotland was independent, we'd be able to rejoin Europe and gain the economic benefits from that.
Question number 6, Neil Bibby.
To ask the Scottish Government what representations it has received from COSLA regarding the local government financial settlement.
Cabinet Secretary.
So the Scottish Government has received a number of representations from COSLA regarding the local government finance settlement. Ministers and officials regularly meet representatives from COSLA and individual local authorities to discuss a range of issues as part of our commitment to working in partnership with local government to improve outcomes for the people of Scotland.
Neil Bibby.
The Scottish Government have claimed the budget makes £570 million more in resources available to councils, but that's not quite true, is it, Deputy First Minister? COSLA say once ring-fencing and directed spend is accounted for, the budget increases council spending by just £71 million in cash terms for Scotland as a whole. Spice have told me that this COSLA figure equates to £304 million in real terms cuts. The Fraser of Allensler Institute say it's a real terms cut, the IFS say it's a real terms cut. Even SNP councillors aren't buying the government's figures. So will the Deputy First Minister drop the spin, face the truth and admit this is a budget for more cuts, closures and strikes across Scotland?
Cabinet Secretary.
The government has allocated £570 million more to local government for the next financial year compared to this financial year, budget bill to budget bill. That is the facts, and that is the reality of the budget uplift that has taken place. Now, in the resource spending review, the position for local government was presented as being flat cash from this financial year to next. We've changed that. We've increased that number by £570 million to enable local authorities, as best we can, within the resources available to us, to withstand the challenges that we all face about inflation. Now, Mr. Bibby knows the way the budget system works. There is a total funding envelope available. It's been allocated in full to portfolios. If Mr. Bibby wishes to change that and to allocate any more money to local government, he has to do Parliament the decent, straightforward, honest thing of telling us where the money will come from. Not to come here in posture, but to tell us where the money will come from.
Question number 7, Murdo Fraser.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government how its budget settlement for local authorities will support the future delivery of quality public services.
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, in 2023-24, local authorities will receive funding through the Local Government Finance Settlement of £13.2 billion. Local authorities also have a range of revenue-raising powers that are not available to other public services. The impact of the settlement on public services will depend on how local authorities allocate the total resources available to them and the level of service they then provide. While local authorities are responsible for setting their own budgets, the total funding provided by the Scottish Government will increase by over £570 million in 2023-24 compared with the 2022-23 budget.
Murdo Fraser.
The Cabinet Secretary claims again that more money is going into local government, but in the real world, councils are having to make savage cuts, including SNP-run councils whose leaders are in revolt. Just this morning, Perth and Kinross Council, that Mr Swinney will be very familiar with, agreed that their SNP leader should write to him expressing extreme displeasure and frustration at being threatened with sanctions rather than being given adequate funding. Now, we've been very clear on this side of the chamber. What Mr Swinney should be doing is scrapping the National Care Service and redirecting that money into local government. But if he's not going to do that, where does he think the cuts should fall? If it's not going to be education, is it going to be in libraries? Is it going to be on leisure services? Is it going to be in arts and culture, on the environment, support for vulnerable families? Or where should the cuts fall?
Cabinet Secretary.
Murdo Fraser does not support the increases in tax that I have announced in this budget. So before Murdo Fraser comes here and tries to argue for any reallocation of money, there is a big, gaping, stonking black hole in his argument. And the big black hole is his unwillingness to take the hard decisions that I've taken about tax. So posturing from Mr Fraser is something I have become accustomed to over many, many years. But having destroyed the public finances with the Truss mini budget, which they wanted us to follow, and then not being prepared to come forward and take the hard decisions on tax, forgive me, Presiding Officer, but I'm going to pay no attention to the critique of the Conservative Party to the budget I've presented.
I've got a number of supplementaries. I'll try to get through as many as possible, but they'll need to be brief, as will the responses. First, Bill Kidd.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Over a decade of Westminster austerity has a substantial impact on the Scottish Block Grant and resources available to fund public services in Scotland. The Cabinet Secretary provide further information on what assessment has been made as to the impact on this austerity it's had on Scottish Government funding and how the levels of revenue funding provided to local authorities in Scotland compare.
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, since the Conservative Government came to office in 2010-11, the average real terms cuts have been of over 5%. This equates to a loss of £18 billion to Scottish Government's budgets over that period. And there will obviously have been consequential effects on local government into the bargain. So the point that Mr Kidd makes is an important point, that the challenges we face of hyperinflation, which has been fuelled by the actions of the Conservative Government and their mismanagement of the mini-budget in September, amongst other things, built onto the effect of austerity, places real enduring pressure on our public services and our public finances.
Daniel Johnson.
COSLA estimate that road spending has fallen by a third. There's a £1.7 billion repairs backlog. Spend since 2010 on children's play parks has fallen by 38%. And in libraries, spending on new books has fallen from £1.79 per person to 92 pence since 2007. So can I just ask what the Cabinet Secretary's assessment is of this budget settlement on those services? And indeed, has the Scottish Government carried out an assessment on the impact on local services of this settlement?
Cabinet Secretary.
There's two points I'd make to Mr Johnson. The first is that I think he would accept that a decade of austerity from the Conservative Government has put cumulative pressure on the public finances of Scotland. I accept that. I would have thought he would have accepted that into the bargain. And the second point is that in the context of a very challenging fiscal environment, with all of the issues and difficulties that we have faced, the Government has increased the resources available to local government by over £570 million. So that cash increase is there for local authorities to deploy in the appropriate way they see fit to meet the challenges in their local areas.
And question 8, Brian Whittle.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what discussions the Finance Secretary has had with the Scottish National Investment Bank and the Bank of Scotland regarding any impact of the repayment terms of the investment in Circularity Scotland in May 2022 on the timetable for the launch of the deposit return scheme.
Minister Lorna Slater.
Scottish ministers meet regularly with the Chair of the Bank and the Bank senior leadership team. As was agreed at its creation, the Bank has operational independence, and so it is not the role of Scottish ministers to intervene in any individual investment process. As set out in the regulations, Scotland's ambitious deposit return scheme will launch on the 16th of August this year. It will be a major part of our efforts to reduce littering, cut emissions, and build a more circular economy.
Brian Whittle.
Thank the Minister for that answer, but when a bank gives a business loan, there will always be an investment memorandum that dictates when the loan will be paid back and the interest that will be paid as part of a return on investment. And furthermore, there will be penalty clauses for any late payment. So is the Minister really suggesting that the bank loans are unique and that there is no timetable for repayment and therefore the impact in the timetable for the launch of the DRS? So what my real question is the decision for the launch financial rather than from business considerations of the businesses that are going to be impacted by this scheme?
Minister.
Thank the member for the question. As I noted in my first answer, investment decisions of the bank are independent of Scottish ministers, and ministers do not intervene in any individual investment process. Our deposit return scheme will launch on the 16th of August this year, as passed by this Parliament as when the go-live date was announced in December 2021.
And briefly, Stuart McMillan.
Thank you. As I understand it, the UK Government has yet to reach a decision on how VAT will be applied to deposits as part of the DRS scheme. Can the Minister provide any update as to the Scottish Government's latest engagement with the UK Government regarding this particular issue?
Minister.
We know how important it is for business to have clarity on the VAT on deposits, and we are working closely with the UK Government to resolve this issue and are seeking action to minimise the risk to the Scottish scheme. I have met UK ministers on a number of occasions on this issue and had asked that it be resolved by July 2022 at the latest. As this was still unresolved last week, the Deputy First Minister wrote to the Chancellor of the Exchequer to request that a decision be communicated this week at the latest, which we are now anticipating. Ultimately, of course, I believe that all tax powers, including VAT, should sit with the Scottish Parliament, and so that the decisions that affect Scotland's businesses and people are made here in Scotland.
Thank you. That concludes portfolio questions. There'll be a brief pause before we move to the next item of business.